Welcome to the program.
Thank you, Tim.
So let's start off looking at a recent survey of 4,000 parents by the state newspaper China Education Paper. It's found that 92% of parents enroll their kids in extracurricular classes, and half of the families spent more than 10,000 yuan on these classes. It's not an insignificant amount of money. Where is all this pressure to spend and to get your kids into after-school programs? Where's that coming from?
For like thousands of years, education has always been like a long-emphasized part of our culture. You can see in China right now, younger generations empowered by education have more chance to change their social status. So that's why parents are so eager to invest behind the education. The other reason, I guess, is also like the dual working parents. Very high penetration of dual working parents in China right now. They just cannot get off their work around 6 p.m. or like 4 p.m. to pick up their kids. They need someone to look after their kids, but not grandparents.
And fill that gap in a productive way.
Yes, exactly.
Right. There's also this interesting term called involution, neijuan in Chinese, like a process of incessant competition where nobody really ends up benefiting.
Mm.
Can you explain that a little bit more and where that phenomenon came from?
I would say it's again to the back starting point that every parents want their kids to be the best. They want to spend literally 10 to 15% of like household income in like more developed cities in China. And with like so much better after school offerings out there, so many tutors providing guidance, helping people to find shortcut to get to the best schools, right? And the competition just like become like younger and younger. Parents become like quite anxious. Intellectually, I do think they get something out of it. But given like the penetration of such activities so high, then it becomes another game that unless you get to the top teachers and things, the bar is higher. In 1990, the bar is here. Now the bar is here, and you in order to be in the top schools, you need to be even higher, and you need more investment into it, and no one wants to be left behind. That's it.
I want to bring in population into this. How is it this whole situation going to be affected by China's changing demographics? We are seeing fewer and fewer young children.
Yes.
And we are expecting the census results to bear that out when they are released.
Yes.
What sort of effect is that going to have on the education market?
You can see from like past 6 months, there are a lot of regulation on schools, on outside of school, like education industry, right? Literally exert control over on their fee collection model, a lot of things. So involution is one of the reason. And then with like very high education spending and cost, younger generation are unwilling to like give birth to kids, right? So that's one of the starting points government is pushing for. But then you might think, oh, with less competition, parents will become less like anxious. My point is with like growing middle class, yes, population is shrinking, but like there's growing population of middle class. Middle class always want to invest in education. This is a universal rule across the globe. Look at US. I mean, who are sending their kids to this kind of enrichment program? It's the richest people, right? So once they have the affordability, it will shift the focus from like intellectual challenging programs to more like sports, arts, and moral relevant stuff. It's just like trying to prepare the kids to be a better person and a well-rounded person. I think this trend gonna continue. It's just like subject-wise or content-wise, it might shift, but the spending is there. The motivation to spend, the willingness to spend is definitely there.
Will that make for happier and perhaps less stressed kids
as
well?
Yes. Hopefully, I think in the long run, 20, 30 years, starting from hopefully tier one cities. Yes. Yeah.
You mentioned also just then that the government has been looking to crack down on some of the players in this industry. And we have heard just sort of in the last couple of weeks, online education providers have reportedly been pulling preschool courses off their platforms. And if the market is still there, aren't these companies just going to slip back into that space?
You're right. Short answer to you is right. So given the high school and university entrance examination, if they remains as it is, this demand cannot be suppressed, to be quite frank, because I'm quite close to those companies as well. I know, I mean, parents' demand can't be suppressed. Parents' demand could be guided. If you think like for kids between like 3 to 6 years old, they need some of the exposure to like different language, may not necessarily be English, right? Arts, sports, you can deliver it in whatever format. Government wouldn't step in to stop you from it. But like tutoring for preschool kids, that's too much. I agree.
It's a huge market though. The overall market for K to 12 after school classes was roughly worth around 800 billion yuan in 2019. And the industry is still expected to grow, you know, rapidly despite some of the setbacks that we saw in 2020 and the shift to an online model. And it's supposed to be worth 1.4 trillion yuan by 2024, according to one of your reports. Now, how is this sort of situation going to change? You know, are the tightening government policies going to affect that? Or how do you see that moving?
Yeah, for sure. So my take on this is because when we forecast the market for that 1.4 trillion RMB thing, we have English language training, we have tutoring, we have enrichment programs. I do foresee English language training and tutoring gonna expect a slower growth, might be like high single digit maximum.
Why a slowdown in English?
In 2020, if you look at all the major players, 50% of their kids are actually between 3 to 6 years old. While the new regulation says like, oh, you should never provide primary school content to like kids who are in the preschool age, which means like 3 to 6 years old kids, and English is considered as a primary school subject. The demand is there, mm-hmm. but English is impacted in that way. But I do think enrichment programs with the new policy going, they will definitely be like quite aggressive in terms of growth.
And in the longer term, do you feel like there are solutions that around to even out some of the imbalances in the education market?
I mean, internet online education, one of the merits of it is definitely by providing quality education from more developed regions to kids like in lower tier cities. Of course, you still have to have the affordability. Maybe in the future, everyone is imagining and designing the next generation of products, including making it more like content appropriate, and also by like affordability wise, more like accessible for larger population. But again, in China, it's not, we easily categorize cities development by tier 1 to tier 7 cities. There's so much layers, different layers of demand in like different city tiers, right? So I would say like it's a long-term efforts by all the key stakeholders.
Thank you so much for joining us. Fascinating insights there.
Thank you, Tim. Yeah, really glad to be here with you.